Hello and welcome. This is Sneha Purkayastha from the Northeastern Chronicle. As we are celebrating the 67th Wildlife Week, so today we have with us Dr. Narayan Sharma sir, Assistant Professor at the Department of Environmental Biology and Wildlife Sciences, Cotton University. At this very outset, I would like to welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So, sir, as many people are unaware of the Wildlife Week, can you please share some light or give ideas to promote it?
Okay, so thank you so much for inviting me to talk on this wildlife during Wildlife Week. First of all, I'd like to say about why Wildlife Week is celebrated. So it's a, as you said, it's the 67th edition of Wildlife Week. It started long back, almost 67 years. So with the constitutions of Indian Board of Wildlife in 1952, and the primary objective of Wildlife Week that has been celebrated from 2nd October to 8th October is to create awareness about wildlife. So since it's a 67th edition, so you know that the concern for wildlife emerged long back. Almost 67th year. So obviously when it started, so it was also to create awareness about the wildlife that we have in our vicinities, in our region, in our country, in our states. And slowly I think as you see that there are a lot of species which started declining even after say 1952. And 1972, there was this Wildlife Protection Act, which gave a very strong protection to many wildlife species, including the wildlife habitat. For example, there was a creation of national park, wildlife sanctuaries, and more recently, we have tiger reserve, we have community reserve. So these are the protected areas. So the main focus, main objective of Wildlife Week is to create awareness so that people know about the, not only about the wildlife, what are the wildlife that we have, but also their precarious conditions, whether the wildlife are doing better or whether wildlife are doing bad, or whether there is a rapid decline of maybe some of these species have gone extinct, that locally extinct from many localities. So basically it's an event where we celebrate wildlife, but also we share concern that what will be the future of those wildlife in our backyard. So in a nutshell, if you ask me what is the motive of Wildlife Week, is to create awareness, but also to share concern. So whether this wildlife are doing good or not.
All right, sir. So many of these things were unknown to me. So I would like to ask the next question, that is, what are your views on the current scenario of wildlife in the Northeastern region?
Okay, so Northeast region, I think all of you know, is in a very, very interesting location, geographically speaking. So it's located in the confluence of three biogeographical realm. So you will have elements of wildlife from Southeast Asia, elements of wildlife from the Palearctic region, that Tibet or China, that those regions, and also element of wildlife from the Indian subcontinent. So its location is very, 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 very interesting. It's juxtaposed in these three biogeographical realm. So that makes Northeast India extremely rich in biodiversity. So if someone asks why Northeast India is so rich, I think this is the answer. And also we have diversity of habitat, you know, right from wetland, grassland, then forest, then secondary forest, tropical rainforest. We have, say, a mountain forest, and also we have Himalayas. So, and there are a lot of wetlands and riverine system. So this diversity of habitat also responsible for having a lot of species. And also because of this uniqueness of this region and the immense biodiversity, there are two biodiversity hotspot areas in Northeast India. One is the Himalayas and another is the Indo-Burma. So when we say about the biodiversity hotspot, this has it has two components. One is that it should have at least 1500 endemic plant species. these are the criteria. The more importantly, it should have lost 70% of the habitat, okay, original habitat. That means it's a good as well as it's like we need to celebrate that we have like 1500 plus endemic plant species, but we should be really cautious that we have already lost 70% of the area. So we have only like a remaining 30% of the original habitat. So when I say about the 30% of say original habitat, this is the matter of concern. When you ask what is the status of Northeast India, we should take pride that we have this many species, but also we should be really concerned that we have lost 70% forest or habitat of this species or forested areas. So this is where the concern of wildlife comes in Northeast India. The biggest concern is the habitat loss and fragmentation. So we have lost many good forested areas. We have lost many grassland areas, patches of grasslands, which are important for species such as Bengal florican, pygmy hog, rhino, and there are lots of birds, species which are found in grassland habitat. So, and also we have lost a lot of tropical forest in the form of either these forests were transformed into, say, tropical, other land use type. For example, a lot of forest has been cleared to, say, expand agriculture, human settlement, and also currently there are this rapid expansion of rubber plantation in some of the tropical areas. So these are the concerns. So we are losing habitat at an unprecedented way. And if this continues, so if you lost the habitat, there are a lot of these wildlife species which are associated with those habitats will be gone. Okay, so for example, you know the plight of pygmy hog. Why pygmy hog are so few in number? So perhaps less than 500 in the wild. So now there are a lot of, because if a species decline to a particular minimum population size, it becomes very difficult for that species to bring from that. And you cannot like ask a species to, okay, now we are giving you protection, you reproduce. So it doesn't work in that way, right? Species have their own biological constraint, the species has their own physiological constraint. So you cannot expand this population overnight. So it took almost 30 or 30 plus year for this pygmy hog conservation program to bring back this species from the mouth of extinction. So, but still a long way to go. So this is one, habitat loss and habitat fragmentation. There are a lot of hunting pressure also in some of the areas. So particularly in some of the hill states, the hunting pressure is very high. And there are a lot of other emerging small but very significant threat like hydropower, yes. For example, the linear infrastructure. So there are this, the climate change. So we hardly talk about the climate change as if the climate change is just in the our imagination. But no, climate change is very, very real. There are evidences that species are now moving upward in some of the areas, so particularly bird species, because the climate is changing, there is a warming. So they cannot cope this addition of some degree Celsius in their physiology, because physiologically they are adapted to a particular range of temperature. So because of this, they're now moving towards upward. For example, if you take a hill, the species are moving towards upside. But the problem is that as soon as you go up, the habitat is not there. So it's like a point of no return. Okay. So all this act independently and also synergistically to to decline species from the. So whatever population they have, 10 years back, most of the species population has declined.
It is indeed a matter of concern, to be honest. So, sir, in the recent past, we have seen some notable incidents which had its effect on environment and its conservation. Like the Baghjan will be a perfect example, the Dihing Patkai. So, sir, what are your views about it?
I think Baghjan and Dihing Patkai both gave some... particularly Dihing Patkai also gives some hope that there was a massive protest about the opening of some of the coal mining areas within the Dehingpatkai Biodiversity Reserve, Elephant Reserve, particularly Elephant Reserve. So I think that Dehingpatkai movement has also given that there are other areas apart from Kaziranga or Orang or say Manas. There are other equally important wildlife areas in Assam, in northeastern India. First of all, the focus was for some point of time, I think people now aware that there is a particular place called Dehingpatkai or Joypur rainforest, and there are a lot of other biodiversity which are there, and this needs to be protected. Okay, that was a and the very fact that lot of youngsters, young youth, came forward with this whatever hashtag I am Dehingpatkai movement. So that actually created awareness about this hitherto unknown areas like Dehingpatkai. So and that I think is very, very promising, and I really like about the youth involvement into it, because it's a youth that is going to be the custodian of this forest in the future. I'll go, or maybe many of the policymakers will go, but I think the youth will remain, and we need to pass on a good forest. We need to pass on a good wilderness to our next generation. So that I'm really heartening to know, and the government of Assam also declared the Dehingpatkai Wildlife Sanctuary as a promoted the wildlife sanctuary as the national park, which is a very laudable initiative. But I think there are a lot of things to do. It's not like if you say declare a wildlife sanctuary into national park, the problems will solve automatically. No, that's absolutely no. There are many forests which are declared as the wildlife sanctuaries, but because of the kind of a mismanagement, this many of these forests are now, the condition is really deteriorated. One example is the where I worked for longer time is the Verjan, Borajan and Padumani Wildlife Sanctuary in Upper Assam. So though it was declared as a wildlife sanctuary long back, but if you go, the condition of this three forest fragments which together call as the Verjan, Borajan and Padumani is deteriorated beyond the recovery. So the mere declaration of the wildlife sanctuary is not enough. I think we need, this is the very good platform from where we need to say try to conserve the Dehingpatkai National Park. I think this is the message that should go to the common people as well as the policy makers. And Baghzan, where I was personally involved in assessing the damage that was done by the this blowout, and so it's very important that we should not promote say extractive activities within a particular area of protected areas, you know. So this kind of event could happen in the future as well. This is not the first time, and this is not the last time that blowout is happening. And so thankfully the blowout was not very at that point of time there was a lot of rain, lot of that's why I think the extent of damage was not went beyond a particular well-defined area, but that itself has created a lot of problems. So dolphins were dead, the lot of birds habitat were dead, and these are the areas like near Baghzan, Motapung Maguri Bill was extremely important bill, because though it's outside the national park areas, but these were the areas where people have described new species. So people have described extension of new species, and these are the areas where there are a lot of endangered species. That means this kind of areas we should identify and protect, and the extractive activities should stop in those areas. So why I'm saying this, because I'm not against of any economic development, but I think economic development should not be at the cost of the environmental protection. And some of the areas, I think we should try to understand the uniqueness of those areas. And there may be other areas where we can do extractive activities, but some of the areas are really important. We cannot just let them go like that.
So, sir, recently there has been a news about center trying to promote the oil palm cultivation in the northeastern region, and many environmentalists are opposing it. So, sir, what do you have to say about its impact?
Yeah. So, I think if you look at the oil palm, the tree as such is not a bad thing, you know. So, if you just look at the yield per hectare, oil palm is the most yielding plant. You'll not get that in any other oil seeds, okay? From that perspective, the oil palm is really good. So yield-wise, it will give a lot of benefit. There is no doubt about it. Second is that the versatility of oil palm. So you'll see the oil palm in every product. So the characteristic that it doesn't have any odor, doesn't have any taste. You can mix it with anything. And it will improve the shelf life of many product. Okay, so you can keep some product for a longer time. Okay, if you mix it with oil palm, but there are a lot of concerns about why oil palm. Why in Northeast India? So because oil palm is also tropical trees. So it's not a Indian tree. It's from the Africa. So it came from Africa. So that tree is when you plant it in some areas, so you cannot say plant it with other trees, just like say there are diversity of trees. So it would be kind of a monoculture, that one crop in the hectares of land. If you look at Malaysia or Indonesia, so there are this areas after area which you see is only palm trees. Okay. So the monoculture is always bad. Okay, so that is one thing. Even species like segun or sal or anything like rubber plantation, the monoculture is bad. So we need, and there are scientifically proven evidences that the more diverse a forest is, more resilient it is. Okay, so now we are talking about say its carbon sequestration's potential. And this forest with the multiple tree species are more, say, ready for a climate change situation than a monoculture plantation. So that is one thing. Second thing is that palm tree, so where will you plant palm? Where there are forest, okay? Because those are the areas which are remain. So you will, there in Indonesia and Malaysia, people cleared tropical rainforest and planted palm. So what happened was there are a lot of species which become endangered. Orangutan is, for example, is a very burning example of the expansion of oil palm and the decline of orangutan. So this is one example of, say, species getting declined. So what happened, and also if they oil palm is aggressively promoted in Northeast India at the expense of the tropical rainforest, this is extremely bad idea. So we cannot, because as I said, we have already lost 70% original forest cover. So whatever left, if you convert those forest into oil palm, that will, it's kind of a recipe for a disaster. So we'll lose species, we'll lose a forest ability to absorb, say, vagaries of climate change. So, and also this is very important from the socio-economic perspective also. So if so during COVID time, if you remember, so I was in one of the wildlife sanctuary in Upper Assam. So people said that, what did you do during the lockdown? I said, all of us went to the forest, got some food and came back, and we hardly had impact from the, say, lockdown. So even there are no vegetables in the market because we cannot go to the market. So we can go to a forest and get vegetables. So this will not be true with the palm. You cannot go and get anything from the palm cultivation because of the monoculture, right? And third thing is that palm oil need a lot of water. So one palm plant need 300 liters of water per day. So okay, agree that there are a lot of, say, water, rainfall is very high in Northeast India. We have plenty of rainfall. But for the last several years, there is a trend that rainfall is, we have a deficit rainfall. So what happened if you clear forest, plant oil palm, and the rainfall fails? Okay, You have lost forest and you are not getting enough yield from the oil palm. And what you have to do, you need to then dig. You need to create, you need to dig borewell to get water. What will happen to the groundwater level in those areas? So these are the concerns, ecological concerns. There are some social, socio-economic concerns as well. Now, there are many areas in, I heard that from the Mizoram where there are a lot of oil palm cultivation. So the farmers are now uprooting the previously planted palm trees and again going back to the shifting cultivation. Because shifting cultivation will give you 28 to 30 kind of different kind of grains or vegetables. So even though it will clear forest, but it's a base suited for that kind of a landscape. So and remember that it also needs water. Okay, so there are these concerns that these are the some of the concerns that actually force the environmentalists to think that oil palm is not a great idea for the particularly fragile ecosystem like the Northeast India. So because we need to learn what happened in Malaysia and in Indonesia, and we should not repeat the same mistake in Northeast India.
All right, sir. Sir, as you are an assistant professor from a reputed university, can you please tell us how do you prepare the next batch of environmentalists and wildlife biologists and what training processes they go through?
Okay. So, yeah, I think that's most exciting part because we started this department in the Cotton University from 2016. The first batch of master's student joined in 2016. And very soon, I think the sixth batch of the master's student will come. And this is also a very learning process for me as well, because till then I was never teaching actively till 2016. I think I also grow with students, so I also learn from them. And so it's a teaching learning process rather than one-way traffic. So I'm going there and giving lecture, but I think we learn jointly, all of us. And what strike me is that our students, particularly from the Northeast India, so we need them to we need to train them. So we need to generate a local resources. So it's not like if something happened to Northeast India, if we need to do some, we need to conserve some of the species. So we cannot like just think, okay, people from Bangalore or people from Delhi or elsewhere will come and save those species. So it's us who need to save those species. So the focus of the teaching is to, first of all, is to understand the science behind wildlife conservation. Because it's important that we know this conservation from a scientific point of view, and also to understand that conservation is not a very simple thing to go and save a species or go and protect a forest. It's a very, very complex issue. So, and we need to have, say, very thorough understanding of human dimension. Our human dimension for this master's project is very important. Conservation you cannot do without, say, keeping behind, say, humans. And also, we also teach them like a kind of a subject like political ecology, which is very important because everything is interrelated, right? So they get to know about the various policies that can influence the conservation on ground. And I think when they come out, and also one very important thing I think most of the students also love to hate is that I really encourage them to do a quantitative thing. So it's not only like going and doing research, but also you need to quantify this. You need to have a statistical rigor to your science so that you can publish this in some reputed journal elsewhere. So this is where we also train them to analyze the data in a proper way so that the scientific community worldwide understand that so these are the situations and these are the results which are generated with a very scientific rigor, right? And also they need to learn mathematics, but there are a lot of field exposure also. So unless you go and involve unless you go and see, touch or feel those things, you will never learn. So that's why the field work is a major component of this project. So we used to take students for the field exposure, so they will go to some forest, protected areas, we spend time together, and we used to go to the field, learn techniques, how to do say population estimation, how to do behavioral sampling. So those things are very important. You may learn all those in a decks, but if you go and try to implement those ideas in the field, you may fail. So that's why the major thrust area is to have a very balanced theory as well as the practical. But also what I really wanted to say impart in students, that I need to generate say capacity building of students from this region, so that we have a many students who will be leading environmentalists in the future. And that is not only the thrust area. If somebody wanted to go for civil service, somebody wanted to go as a school teacher, they can go with some ecological mindset, so that in future, if they see something, they can use all the scientific knowledge they have acquired during masters, and they can solve those problems. So this is the thrust area. And also, we are also creating awareness by going and interacting with the school children, with the villagers. So these are the various activities that we have been doing in the department.
It sounds really interesting. Sir, what do you have to say about the socio-economic impact and the impact of urbanization in Diporbil?
Yeah, I think Diporbil is also, like, first of all, we need to really ask whether we need Diporbil or not.
Yes.
First thing. If yes, then we need to save Diporbil, because in the current form, where there are a lot of the garbage which is being dumped very near to Diporbil. So the Diporbil is like a gasping for air. So this Diporbil is asking for our help, right? And the worldwide, the appreciation of green and blue space, so blue space means like water bodies, is growing. So there are cities which are keeping aside many areas for a green space and for the blue space. Okay, they are dismantling some of the existing infrastructure, and they are converting this into blue or green spaces. So this is the requirement, actually. So we cannot have all the buildings in city, okay, and then go outside for picnic or something. Then what is happening now is that the existing bills, okay, in Guwahati, there are many bills which have been encroached upon. So the area of the bills are almost now, if you compare the area before, this boom in urbanization in Guwahati, and currently, you will be surprised to see that most of the bills are not there. So apparently there are around 40 bills in Guwahati. So how many bills we can count? Maybe less than 10, maybe less than 5. So bills are important, because they also absorb, absorb water, so that there is no artificial flood in Guwahati. So perhaps the artificial flood which happens after a heavy downpour is the result of us encroaching the bill, right? Or we completely eliminating the wetlands. So perhaps that is the one of the reason. And Diporbil, I think, is from that perspective is very important, because it not only support a lot of migratory birds, a lot of biodiversity, but also it's helping Guwahati to cope up with the artificial flood. I think we need to understand the importance of Diporbil for Guwahati. And Diporbil not only for birds, if you know that there are the large mammals like elephants which are coming and spending time, even the very fact that the name itself says that it's a deep means in Sanskrit is hathi. Elephants, and bill means wetland. So these are like a very linked. So the port bill is for the elephants, okay? And the current the railway track there is actually causing a lot of problems for the port bill, the elephants. More than, I think, close to 15 elephants were killed from 2001 to that particular stretch of railway line. And there was also death of one person in that. So I think we need to really think whether we need Diporbil in this current stage. And one of the important thing that we need to do is to restore this bill to some extent of its original position. So then only I think we'll do justice to the poor bill. And there is, I spoke to various people and many people, and everybody said that we need the poor bill, but I think we need action also. So so we cannot allow this poor bill to go just like other bills in the Guwahati city.
Surely we need the poor bill. Sir, previously you talked about political ecology. Can you please elaborate on it?
Okay. So, you know, there are a lot of these things, conservation biology or conservation science is not only about just saving species. It's also about working with people, right? So, political ecology is a science where we try to understand the relationship of a human with the society, with the nature. So there are a lot of decisions which are being made that has a political repercussions. Okay, so I think while taking decisions to some resource management, it's very important that we understand the policies behind it. Okay, so without knowing the policies, so it's sometimes you have all the good intention, but you cannot execute those program, because of there are a lot of as I said, that these are a lot of complex issues. Okay, so we need to take together everybody and work towards the conservation. So human people, so everybody are a stakeholder in conservation of nature, right? We cannot dismiss like, okay, this is only for wildlife or this is only for the humans. Okay, so there's, we need to have a joint effort, okay, where we can use these political ideas to conserve our biodiversity.
All right, sir. So, sir, what do you have to say to the youngsters today to divert their attention towards wildlife?
Okay, so I think the best thing is to just go out of your house, okay? Even if you have a backyard, or if you cannot go to fancy places like Kajiranga or some other exotic places in Kenya or some other places, you go outside any forested area and try to learn something about it. So what is that particular tree in your college, or what is that particular species that you have seen? So for example, there are plenty of butterflies in Guwahati. There are plenty of spiders in Guwahati. The biodiversity is there in your backyard, so you do not have to go very, very far. I think what we need to do is to connect with nature, okay? By observing them, reporting them, right? There are a lot of these different portals now where whatever you observe, you can upload your observation there. If you do not know the scientific name, perfectly fine. But as long as you are describing this correctly or capturing them with your, now all of us have cameras in our cell phone, we can click this and we can upload it. There are a lot of experts who will guide you. So once we built our relationship, even the youngster, they built the relationship with nature by observing nature, they will involve in the nature related work automatically. And when they are involved in the nature related activities, they will also protect the nature. Otherwise, without involvement, they cannot protect. So I think it's very important that we come out of our houses and go and explore nature in I don't know, maybe your campus, your offices, your school, anywhere there are biodiversity. So birds are everywhere. You can just go out and watch the birds and contribute to science, something called the citizen science. And then you involve with it. Then I think you'll see that slowly it's not only help protect nature, but it will also help you there are a lot of examples which say that if you go out and enjoy nature, involve in nature, that will have a very good mental well-being. The people go out and involve with the nature can cure some of the mental disorders. For example, if you have anxiety, if you are a bit depressed, so because that, you know, like that's going to be a next kind of a pandemic. It's a pandemic awaiting. So this is where I think nature is helping. And it's the service is free of cost. You can go and it will not charge you. So if you go and ask to take a picture, it will not going to charge you any amount of money. But what you are doing is you are not only documenting. So, and by doing that, you may stumble on some new spaces. So then I think the students will have to get involved, and then only they will be able to save their spaces and protect their habitats.
All right, sir. It is indeed a pleasure to have you with us today, sir. It was a very valuable session. Thank you for giving us your valuable time.
Thank you so much.
For more such videos, keep watching the Northeastern Chronicle.